Today I want to first start with a session about the video codecs behind modern remote display protocols, because many of those vendors like Citrix or VMware or even Nutanix Frame use video codecs to compress the data between the VDA and the endpoint. But what is the codec behind it? How does it work? So let's dig it in a little bit deeper into that in this session. So, my name is Rodi Kosse. I'm a consultant at PQR. I'm also a Citrix CTP since this year and an NVIDIA and GCA member. And as you can see, I like to play games on Xbox and ride on my bike. So the agenda for today's session is first the basics of the video codecs, the things behind it that you need to know before you can understand how it works. And then we will dig deeper into one of the most common ones, H.264. I call it the magician. And then I will just tell something about the other codecs we see in the market. And if I have time left, I will tell you something about the hardware support for it, especially on NVIDIA. So, the basics. Let's start with some terms you may be seeing in the market or see on the internet. But as you can see, there are so many different things you can tell about video codecs. So, things like lossy versus lossless, or B2-2020, or YUFI-444. What do they mean? And do you have to care about it? So let's first start with colors, because we never really perceive what color really is as it is physically. This fact makes color the most relative medium in art. So this quote just says that color is personal, because Ruben and I are here in the same room. We are both looking to the same slide. And I think we are both seeing the colors differently, because they are based on how our brain works, and it's personal. And it's also a perception, because our brain works in a very funny way. So I have a screenshot here with a checkerboard, and from our perspective, A and B are different colors. But are they? If we connect them, we suddenly see that they are the same color. And if I have a gradient background with in the middle a gray bar, which is just a solid color, suddenly the middle bar is also gradient. And it's reversed. It's really cool how our brain works. I can't tell you what the real color is. I haven't checked with the color picker yet, but I think it's somewhere in the middle. So the human eye can only see around 10 million colors. But there are species like pigeons. They're stupid because they shit on everything, but they see more than 10 billion colors. They even see UV light and so on, because there's so much more to see than we can see with our eyes. But if we go back and go back to humans, so if you're colorblind, you can maybe only see 40,000 colors. So that's much less than a normal person with a complete eyesight. So it really depends on your own brain, how it works, how it perceives the light, how you process the colors. So what does that mean for colors in a virtual world, in a computer? So the first part to describe colors is bit depth. It's the amount of different colors. And you can describe it in two ways. It's used different by every vendor. You can describe it as the bits used to indicate the color of a single pixel. So for example, 24-bit. Or you can describe it as the number of bits used for each color component. So how many bits for red, green, or blue. So for example, 8-bit. And the colors can also be combined with extra bits for alpha, which describes transparency and how colors overlay and which color is more dominant. So if you look at the most commonly used, back in the days I started I think with high color 16-bit, which is just around 32,000 colors, which can also be upgraded to 64,000 because there's one unused bit and that was added to green, if I'm correct. And with that extra bit, you can get 64,000 colors. If you look to the most common these days is true color, 24-bit. I think if you check your laptop now, go to your screen settings, you will use 24-bit color. So it means 8 bits per color, and that's 60 million different colors. That's more than our eye can see. But the difference is that it's in a different spectrum. So there are more colors from dark green to light green described in this 60 million. And it doesn't completely compare to our vision, because our vision has more colors than you can see here. Another one which is coming up now these days in ultra HD Blu-rays is deep color, 30-bit. It contains 10 bits per color, which means 1 billion colors. But it's still not all we can see. It's just a more gradient view. And you can see here how that works in this picture. I hope it's visible on the webinar. But on the left side, you have the 10-bit color with 1 billion colors. And on the right side, the normal 60 million colors. So you can see there are a lot more colors between in the spectrum than on the right side, which makes the gradient less harsh in the left picture. So it's much more smooth between the different colors. So I already mentioned that those colors aren't everything we can see. So on the right side, you see a picture of a color gamut. And it compares the most common standards, which are used on Blu-rays and ultra high definition Blu-rays. And the surrounding boxes describe what our eyes can see. So as you can see, we miss really a lot in the digital world. We can't reproduce all the colors on the screen yet. So there on the left side, you can see some standardized gamuts. You might recognize Adobe RGB for the Adobe Photoshop users. sRGB is the most common one for computer graphics. Another thing in digital imagery is compression. There are different levels of compression and different terms for it. So lossy means that you lose data. It's irreversible. I hope it's also visible, but on the right side, you can see lossy compression. The image quality is lower than on the left side, even though it's the same picture. And you can use it to reduce data size. And for example, it's used in MP3s, JPEG, or MPEG. On the other end, we have lossless compression, which is reversible. And some examples are zip files, because if they were unreversible, all your data would be corrupt. But it's also used in PNG, FLAC for audio, or Dolby 2HD. And another term you might see, and it's introduced, I think, by Citrix or NVIDIA, is visually lossless. It's irreversible, but it's on such a level that we can't see the difference. There are also different ways to describe colors in a computer system. So the most common one is RGB, but this has its limitation because it's per pixel. There's another one, which is YCBCR, and it describes the Y, luma, or brightness of the color, and the CR and the CB describe the color difference. And it's based on the idea that our visual system is less sensitive for color than luminance. So we can't really see the difference between light blue and a bit of light blue, but we can see if it's less bright. You can convert RGB lossless to ICBCR, and it's also known as YUFI. But YUFI was from a analog system, but it's still used as it is the same term. Chroma subsampling uses YUFI to reduce the amount of color information, which can reduce the file size, even up to 50%. But it allows the picture clarity to be maintained. So here you have some examples of chroma subsampling. So in the upper left corner, you have 444, which means there's no downsampling. And a very common one in the right bottom corner is 420, which means that in a block of 4 pixels, only the upper left one is used. But all the luma, the first four, is maintained. And the 2 means that on the upper row, only the first left 2 corners are used. And the 0 means the B and the B, the bottom one, none of them are used. So in this way, you really reduce the amount of information, but you lose color. In moving images, this can't be seen. But for example, if you have text, on the right side, you have YUFI 444. So no compression, and on the left side you have 420, where you can see that the dark blue and the red are mixing together and are harder to read. And even lines will, for example, in 2D CAD, will be less visible. So these are the basics of the video codecs. If we dig deeper into H.264, we'll see those terms come back and you will see how these are used, because H.264 is really a magician. I used a blog for this as a source, so I put also the link in here. It's very interesting to read. And it really goes down, digs down into how it works. But first, why do we even need a video codec? Well, it's all about size, because if you see how much one single frame even uses, if you don't compress it, it's very simple to calculate. As you can see here, I've made a simple calculation. Full HD with 24-bit colors, so 60 million colors, costs almost 6 megabytes of storage. So for 30 frames per second, it means 177 megabytes per second of throughput. If we even go to 4K, 60 frames per second, it's more than 1 gigabyte per second of data throughput. That's why you also see that HDMI has a throughput of around 60 gigabit per second, because it's uncompressed between your receiver and your screen. So there's quite some history in video codecs. The most common one is H.264. Around now, I think most of you also remember DivX or XVIT. Back in the days, it was MPEG-4 encoding. And there are some newer ones like H.265 and AV1, which even compress the image further. So H.264 was introduced in 2003 as a standard on most Blu-ray videos now. It uses the Rec. 709 color space. And the hardware support is in every device, I think, around now. As I said earlier, H.264 is really like magic. If we compare the size of a screenshot and a H.264 stream, it's really different. So I made a screenshot of the tweakers.net homepage. It's around 880 kilobytes. I also created a H.264 5-second movie with 30 frames per second. It's only 400 kilobytes in size. So it's half the size, but it contains 150 frames. Cool, huh? What? Yeah, it's smaller. But How do they do that? So there are a few tricks. First is entropy. Information entropy is the number of bits required to represent some information. So it describes how many bits you require to save the data. And entropy is used in most deduplication engines. So a simple example to describe entropy is if you cuss a coin for 12 times, you can say, okay, six times it landed on head, 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 tail, 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 or you can just say six times head and six times tail. And in the second example, you already deduplicated the data because you created two values and created a mapping array how much times that data was used. The second trick they use is chroma subsampling. So in most video streams, they use YUV420, which is only a third of the bandwidth compared to 444. Another trick is to use quantization, which builds on a frequency domain. It's a really strange thing because they transform the image to representation of level of detail. So for example, if you look at the picture on the right side, you see a bar with small holes on it. That's an area with high level of detail. If you map that to a frequency domain representation, you get some sort of graph on the right side where the outer bounds are the high levels of detail and the center is the low level of detail. So high frequency means high detail is the border and low frequency is gentle details like your fingers or other parts of the black of the screen, which is the center of the representation. And with the quantization, you filter out the high detailed areas. And it can be lossless if you leave enough of the frequency. And it massively reduces the image size. So if you compare these five images, so on the left side, we have an uncompressed image. And if we go back in the middle, you only have 30% of the image size left, but you can hardly see the difference. You have to look really good. Even at 11%, it's hard to see the difference. So this is mainly used to compress the video. Another and the last thing is motion compensation, because what if you watch tennis and you throw a ball over the net and you only follow the ball, then that's the only part of the picture and you have a static camera, then only the ball is moving. So why don't decompress or use only that part of the image and send it over and reuse the previous frame? So with motion compensation, they predict the frame by the previous or future frames, and the frame is sliced in different sizes. And it can contain three types of frames. So you have an iframe or a keyframe, which holds the complete image. You have a P frame, which is predicted. It holds only the changes from the previous frame, which is laid over the iframe. And you have a B frame or a bidirectional predicted. It's the difference between the current frame and the preceding and the following frame. So on the right side, you can see some examples of it. So it's a Pac-Man movie, where you can see that only Pac-Man is moving into the balls, and you can see how it works. So they predict what's next and place that into the frame, which massively reduces the amount of storage needed. So the result is that a uncompressed video is around, for 5 seconds, 30 frames per second, is around 900 megabytes. And if we compress it, it's just around 400 kilobytes. That's in the reduction of 2,000 times. That's amazing how they do it. So that was H.264. And there are some other codecs used, like H.265, which is introduced for Ultra HD 4K because they needed more compression. So it's built to reduce bitrate, but it uses 8 more times CPU than H.264. VP9 was developed by Google. It's open source, royalty free, supported by most devices, mainly used on YouTube. And the last one is HV1, created by the Alliance for Open Media. And it was just released last year. It's open source, relatively free. And it has a 20 to 40% higher data compression than even VP9 and H.265. And I think around 60% than H.264. Hardware and video encoding and decoding is not commonly available. And if you look at the speed currently on Intel CPUs, you can see that there's a massive difference. So just 80 frames per second encoding speed for a full HD stream on a 2x65 core Intel Xeon. In comparison, with the same setup, you get 365 frames per second for H.265. So I had some slides about hardware support, which I'm gonna do in the next session because I'm at the end of my time. And we will share the slides as well, so you can look them up in your own time whenever you want. So thank you for now, and let's move on to the next session.